welcome everybody to the Agronomists. It's great to be back for another week of, this is the fourth episode of this great new show that we've honestly had a ton of great feedback on, and I'm really looking forward to tonight's episode. Of course, we are live here in prime time, so it's a little bit lighter, informative, and we're going to have some fun with both our two guests. I want to encourage you, if you do have a question or a comment, participate in the program, whether you're watching on YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, or Twitch. We are here to learn all together, and I just don't want to hog the mic in terms of the questions. I want you to participate as well, no matter where you are farming in the country. Maybe we even got some American watchers tonight, or people from Europe as well. That's middle of the night for Europe. What else we got here? Remember, the CCA credits will be open in the morning. Go to the website, realagriculture.com/agronomist, and you can enter in that you watched tonight's show. And, well, that's about it. Let's get to our guests here. Let's bring them in. It is the fun and fantastic guys from Sprayers 101. You know them across the country. Let's start off here. We got Jason Deveau from OMAFRA. Jay, how are you?
I'm well, Sean. How are you?
I'm doing great. It's Monday night. It's where else would I rather be? Forget about Monday Night Football, as I say. Let's talk agronomy.
I love to be in my office in the middle of the night, so sure.
Absolutely. Also joining us is Tom Wolf, based out of Saskatchewan. Tom, how are you?
I'm good, Sean. You?
Pretty good. I'm doing fantastic. So, guys, we've done a lot of stuff together, and you guys have really done a fantastic job of shaking things up in terms of agronomic extension. And I guess that's kind of the tonight's theme a little bit, is shaking up the status quo. Tom, you're always trying to help and assist agronomists and growers, trying to find some different ways of looking at some of the ways we've been doing things with our sprayer in the field throughout the growing season.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, my dad used to tell me, don't ever become betriebsblind, which is a German word for a business blindness, which means you just get used to stuff. You know, you get used to what you shove in the corner. It's always been there. Might not belong there though. And he always encouraged me to have a fresh look at stuff. And I've carried that forward with me in my whole life. And it's a challenge though. It's a challenge to be critical of things that some people think are pretty good. But you always just have to think of, well, what's our actual objective and are we meeting it?
Yeah. Is that one of the things, Jason, is to make sure you have an objective? Is that a part of the whole thing?
Well, Tom said this in the past, and I agree, not to turn this into the Tom fan show, but you have to measure things to understand them before you can change them. So until you're willing to step back and look objectively at what you're doing, you may not even recognize you have a problem. And that is really hard to do when nothing seems broken. One of the biggest challenges with anyone is first convincing them they have a problem so that you can offer them the solution to fix it.
Yeah. Jason, Tom, we're already getting questions. Janine wants you. Can you please spell that word for us? What was it again? It's
one of those German compound words. It's Betriebsblindheit. Well, I'll write it down for you, Janine.
We made it a whole minute before Tom used a German word. I'm impressed.
He's just out there trying to outdo both of us, Jay. That's what he's doing. Okay,
so I don't even try.
Tom, what do you consider to be some of those things where we, because there's a lot, it's not just spraying. There's a lot of things in agriculture where we hang on to a little bit the way we've done things. And that's a natural human tendency. Change it's difficult. It's hard. And you know, in farming, a lot of the things are passed down from generation to generation. Now, that really is an advantage in some cases, but sometimes it can sort of it could be a bit of a negative or maybe an opportunity for improvement. Where do you see some of those things in terms of spraying where maybe we could shake up the status quo a little bit?
Yeah, you know, it's a great observation. You know, agriculture, I'm comfortable in the culture. It's a culture based on, you know, has a lot of values, right? And there's traditions, and of course, things we're very proud of in that regard. But at the same time, it's also one of the most science-friendly occupations, vocations, whatever. People are literate in the latest research. It's really kind of cool that way. So it's both extremes in some ways, right? And you know, what I always try to do is just find ways of improving the situation. You know, I try to say, all right, what are we trying to do here? And the pressures are great. Like we really are spraying more than ever, more times per acre than ever before. The weather seems to be, you know, holding us up most of the time. So we have to do more acres per hour. That's the currency we're talking about here. So everything that I do and say, I try to weigh in that reality. And one of the things I try to do is I certainly shut doors. I say, don't spray during inversions. Don't spray when it's too windy, et cetera. Don't spray at night. But for every door I shut, I have to open at least one other one so that we keep the acres per hour alive. So that creates this inventiveness of, okay, how do we get more done? Is that even possible? And that's how Jason and I have come up with productivity issues, right? Where is the productivity actually missing? And where can we, how can we gain it back?
And we're going to watch a video here in very, very short order that really showcases one of the ones where people try to make those productivity gains being speed, and it may be a bit of a mistake. But Jason, is it, you know, Tom's talking, you know, Tom's experience is a lot, of course, you know, really focused on the Western Canadian situation. Jason, do you see the same thing from a fruit and veg standpoint where your specialty has been?
Totally. I mean, he hit it on the head. When you close one door, you open another door. That's not just to keep the client engaged or, you know, to let them to let them know that you're being realistic with the things you're asking them to do. But it's because every situation is unique. There are a whole number of opportunities and pressures that are unique to each operation, to each operator, so that when they say, I have a problem, you can offer four or five solutions that may partially address that. And then together you can pick the one that's either the most palatable or makes the most financial sense, or even if they're willing to make the change. And I think we have to be humble in the things we ask operators to do. Change should be incremental. You almost have to coax them along. Small victories that raise their confidence and pay dividends to encourage them to take the next step. Occasionally we meet the courageous operator that wants to leap ahead of us. I've met a few. And they're fantastic and rare, but you have to almost restrain those people. And it all boils down to feedback. You know, and this is interesting. When we try to convince someone that we have the problem, you have to show them that problem. And if they don't recognize the thing they've immediately done has caused that problem, then they can't be convinced. So, you know, one of the biggest tools that Tom and I use in education is cause and effect. And water-sensitive paper is a great way to do that. It's quick and dirty, and it engages the operator. Any small victory with them is how we keep our foot in the door.
Well, and talk about getting feedback from the audience or from farmers. Tom, you know, when it comes to that idea of the pit stop, of that sprayer downtime, you've often credited Manitoba farmer, I think it's Ron Cron, if I remember right, with kind of putting that, you know, kind of getting you focused on that topic as an example.
So much, so true. It's Ron that said, you know, when he first got his new tender vehicle, he said, yeah, it's like a NASCAR pit stop, 7 minutes. And I said, wow. And I'm inspired by guys like Ron, and there's so many in Western Canada, Eastern Canada, all over North America that are my actual, you know, motivation. You know, I learned so much from those guys, from those people, everyone. And you know, they're the types that are doing what I said at the beginning. They're questioning the status quo. They're saying, how can we do this better? And it takes a certain amount of discipline to do that. It takes a certain amount of drive, right? And thinking out of the box and being original and coming up with solutions. And much of the time, like Jason said, these things are incremental. Like we find small things, but they can become meaningful. And, you know, many times they just give you joy. You know, there's always these little things. My dad always takes me, I talk about my dad a lot, but he always shows me the little things he's done to make his everyday life a little easier. On the farm, he always said they put handles and levers and, you know, doors and things and just said, okay, you know, this is now 1 minute faster or that much easier. And then it just gives us happiness, and spring's the same way.
And 1 minute faster over the course of, you know, 2 weeks of spraying, that's productivity, right? like sometimes productivity gains don't need to be like this leaps and bounds, and you know, we increased our productivity by 33%. It's hard to find that kind of gain on a regular basis. It's sometimes that little small, little incremental sort of changes. And it's not changing big things. It could just be changing small things. It's like getting back to that FedEx delivery person where they're monitoring the exact movements. What is the most efficient way to get out of the vehicle, the van, to deliver that package? Jason, what are you going to say?
No, you're right. The devil's in the details. When I was a kid, I love this story because I'm telling it and I get to talk now. I had a paper route, and there were times that I would deliver this route and just zone out. You get used to repetitive behavior. And if something's working, you're not going to change it. And there was many a time that I would just sort of snap out of it when I was back at the house with an empty mailbag, but I couldn't begin to tell you where I went or what I did. So probably when it comes to incremental change and getting someone to be objective, a stopwatch, a pen, and a piece of paper is probably the biggest tools we could recommend. Stand back and look at yourself. Don't zone out, but really pay attention. And when you recognize how many times you walk around the sprayer, when you recognize how many times you run to see if the water's up to the top, and you add up how often you're doing that, those 1 minute become a lot of valuable time. And I won't jump the gun on this, but what you can do with that time is pretty sensational.
I love, for example, just the idea of having a data set, having the data set and then being creative with its analysis, right? You can plot it this way or that way. You can tease this out of it or that. It's the science that we talked about earlier is in that. And a lot of, our clients do just that. And they learn.
You have a calculator for that, don't you, Tom?
Yeah, I do have we have a productivity calculator on our website, don't we, Jason? Well, let me gather some inspiration. It's
this. There you go.
He's trying to catch us. Hold it up.
I keep on trying to catch you guys.
Spurs101.com. Paid for you, farmers listening, by your commodity group. So thank you very much.
There you go. Absolutely. Okay. I got to bring the camera all back. What we're going to do is we are going to watch our first clip. And I sort of teased it a little bit here. It has to do with people trying to gain productivity by driving the sprayer faster. Now, some of you maybe have not seen some of these clips before. I want to introduce them. Tom and Jason have done a great job with the team at Real Agriculture to put together the sprayer myth videos and really kind of tackling some of these things that some of these misconceptions that are out there. And they've worked very, very closely with Bernd Tobin of realagriculture.com, as well as video producer Jay Strovey, and some great stuff. Completely a different, sort of taking ag extension and sort of flipping it on its head and having some fun with it and educating in a pretty cool way. So let's watch the first clip here of Spray Myths on Speed. Here we go.
Did you see that field back there? That dust cloud, that was unsprayed just 5 minutes ago.
Are you telling me that you sprayed that whole field just now?
You better believe it, baby. 375 horsepower, air ride, fast is the way to spray.
Actually, Jason, that's a myth.
Look, the farm's big, time's short, I have to drive fast to cover ground. That's why I decided to buy one of these.
I get your enthusiasm. It's both fun and easy to drive fast, but have you ever thought of the downsides?
Downsides? To rocking the sprayer race circuit? The only one I can think of is where to hang my trophies.
Fast travel speed increases drift as it pulls small droplets away from the spray pattern. It also generates more dust, which can hurt pesticide performance. Fast speeds require high booms that increase drift potential. High booms and high speeds create poor spray patterns. Wheel tracks are more of a problem. There's the equipment wear and tear. Modern sprayers weigh a lot and those bumps take their toll.
Is there any good news? Any at all? Just a tiny bit?
There's plenty of opportunities for higher productivity. We just have to think in terms of minimizing downtime.
Oh, like a fast pit stop!
That's right. Try to think of the time you're spending not spraying. You can think about pre-mixing products that require more hydration time, or think of ways of cleaning your sprayer faster. We found that those kinds of improvements increase your productivity more than just speed alone.
Well, I suppose I could get wider booms instead of a new sprayer, or a bigger tank, or even an auto rinse system to reduce downtime. Thanks, Yoda! Tom?
Welcome, you are. May the Force be with you.
Yeah, those are pretty funny and good. Exactly. Well, and you know what? There's questions coming in here from Daryl. Why haven't I seen these before? Daryl, that's on you. They've been out there, man. Come on. On the Facebook page, Lindsay actually shared the link to all the different spray myth videos. So please, we're going to play a couple more here yet. But, you know, Tom, I've seen you give this talk several times. This is like one of those things that plays with your brain. You know, if I just went a little bit faster, just goose that sprayer a little bit more, because sprayers are getting bigger. Jason joked about it in the video. I got 350 horsepower. Let's rock it, baby. It's not necessarily a good thing.
It's amazing. When we did the numbers on productivity, you know, even something as innocuous as making a turn at the end of your swath takes up to 25% of your total driving time in the field. So, you know, you want to minimize the turns, right? And a lot of other things came out of these kind of, you know, we did these scenarios, and it's been a lot of fun. And even, you know, and Jason, in your work with the Orchard Air Blast, you know, shorter runs, more turns, and probably much more opportunity for improving efficiency because you have these smaller fields and more intense applications.
It's all the same math. I've got the added complication that if you go too fast, you don't give air an opportunity to carry the spray where it needs to go. It ends up sort of getting pulled behind the sprayer. So it's a double jeopardy for the operator. You may have gotten done quicker, but you left a flaming trash heap behind you. So was it really worth it? With the field sprayers and to the video, this goes back to what we were saying, that there are several opportunities to do a better job. And yeah, the shocker is driving fast isn't one of them. You told me, Tom, when you got a hold of some numbers about engine time versus spray time, how much time is actually spent spraying versus how long the sprayer is on? What is it?
Yeah, it's you know, it's somewhere between 40% and 50% at, you know, if it's good. It could be even worse than that. So most of our productivity is lost when we're not spraying. Once we're moving that sprayer, things are pretty good. You know, let's face it, things rarely go wrong and we're driving up and down and so on and so forth. But it is the little things, and there's dozens of them, you know, stopping to correct an entry in your monitor on your field stats, those kinds of things. Doing some math on figuring out, well, what does that last load need in terms of chemical and water? You know, so those things quickly become 2, 4, 5, 10 minutes. Considering that you can empty your whole tank in 20, that's a significant proportion of your driving time. So these little things add up, and they really sneak up on you. So you have to keep abreast of it all.
Well, I got to comment.
I almost feel like I should be the devil's advocate here.
Go ahead.
There are some things you don't compromise. And we've been guilty of this. When you find out how long it takes to fill a sprayer, and you say, get a tender truck and a 3-inch line, and you know, as fast as you can get the chemistry in, you're trying to catch up with the fill water. You don't want that to outstrip you. But sometimes you can go too far, right? So there are a lot of – I spent about 2 years with Mike Cobra, our provincial weed specialist, looking at tank mixing and incompatibilities, physical and chemical. And now in my neck of the woods, we use a lot of dry products. It's less and less in field sprayers. But it's astonishing what water that is slightly too cold with a product put in and not allowed to dissolve will do to your tank mix. So people trying to be efficient and trying to be productive should also recognize which factors, you know, have no more wiggle room. You shouldn't push them.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Tom. It's so true. Just think of the mess to clean up after. I mean, that's a real, you know, it's like getting stuck, you know, it's like it takes a lot of your day.
Yeah.
Here's a comment from sort of we're talking about from Jenneth. She says, I purchased a 30 metric ton tender trailer 2 years ago. It has saved much time for loading and keeping sprayer rolling, kind of exactly nice. What we were talking about here. Doug says fast pit stops. Absolutely.
Hey, Doug. You know, and Doug makes the Praxidon. He's so that's a very innovative tender system. He has really thought about it. He's tried to put himself into the applicator's shoes and said, all right, how can we eliminate some of the problems? Metering, for example, just knowing how much product flows into is in the tank. And there's these meters that are sometimes good and sometimes not so good. And Doug has really talked about that and developed a product that's very, very good at it. And he weighs, you know, he has, for example, he's got a load cell in his inductor cone. So he weighs this stuff too, and record keeping. So you have compliance and you have record keeping of your inventory. It's a fantastic integrated system.
Cool.
We learn so much from retailers like Doug, but we also learn a ton from the operators. They're the ones that are out there 12, 13, 14 hours a day or more with a lot of time to think. And when Tom started talking about tender trucks and those efficiencies for loading, we turned to the growers who were happy to tell us on Twitter and any other way we would engage them how they found ways to make things better. And Tom put together an article based on all the home builds of tender trucks and filling and loading systems. And it remains today. It actually ended up being a two-parter. It was just such a big article. It's our number one hit on that website.
Well, it makes sense, though, because Tom, I think it was Tom that said, we're spending more time in the sprayer than we ever have before.
Yeah.
And, you know, a lot of the audience tonight, the other people that are giving recommendations to farmers because they're CCAs or, you know, they're agronomists. And so that's becoming more of a complex recommendation too, right? We just don't have a situation where we're recommending one product across the whole farm on one crop type. Due to things like weed resistance, it's getting a little bit more complex. So we're going to get the sprayer clean out here in a little bit, but the complexities are increasing. So you got the more changes and you're trying to be more productive because you got more acres to cover more times. This productivity equation is becoming more and more of a thing. I think it sort of all adds up.
It does. And the equipment, like if you look at the numbers, you know, if you're farming 10,000, I mean, that's a lot of acres, but you're running your sprayer 500 hours a day, a year. And, you know, the typical work year for a 9-to-5er is 2000 hours. So we're talking about a quarter of your whole, you know, work time in the sprayer.
Yeah.
That is a pretty astounding number.
Well, and you know, I got a comment here from Daryl who's watching on Facebook, and I was kind of picking on Daryl earlier when he said, where have these videos been? Daryl, you have exactly made my point. That's why we've been incorporating clips from the realagriculture.com vault to get some of these things back out in front of the audience, because you know there's so much agronomic content on our website. I actually am absolutely smiling from ear to ear the fact that you pointed that out. That you haven't seen some of these clips before. So that is awesome. So I appreciate it. I'm not making too much fun of you. What do we got here? Jenneth says, flushing time is an issue, especially if you are switching products to meet agronomic requirements. Exactly. Just what we were talking about.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
You know, we, Jason and I had a discussion earlier this week, or last week, I guess it was, where we talked about what if, you know, we agreed on a standard that said, okay, it shouldn't take more than 10 minutes to reduce the residual amount of chemical in your system by 20,000 fold, which makes it safe enough for dicamba. Why are we selling equipment that can't do that in the first place? Because it creates these problems. And then farmers have to guess at how to solve that for themselves, or make changes. And I mean, some of them are very, very useful, like the continuous rinsing, but why isn't that a standard feature? I mean, some of these features, you wouldn't be able to sell a car without seatbelts, you know, or other safety features, right? There's standards there. We have fewer in the sprayer business, and maybe there's a place for them.
Definitely. I have friends that are part of the ISO group, and they mind-bendingly debate for hours where these what features sprayers should have for safety, for effectiveness, for productivity. Those standards are out there. Europe is replete with them, but they seem to sink on the boat over here to North America. I don't know why that is. We don't have to look very far to find these standards, but we don't, nobody talks about them. It's not even a matter of compliance. They're not even aware of them. So quite often people hear us talk about the divide between North American sprayers and European sprayers. And I suppose it depends which side you're on that the other side looks better. But we wonder why they've evolved so differently.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, you know, we're the land of the free, right? We're the last frontier that's relatively unregulated in North America.
Cowboys.
And so, you know, maybe we are. But you know what? I mean, I don't like regulation. However, it does have a purpose. And if it improves the efficiency of an operation or the safety of an operation, people buy into that kind of stuff. And if it, and you know, the saying is a rising tide raises all ships. If we have a standard that all people have to ascribe to, then all products will become better, as opposed to having to hunt and find the ones and still have some things that shouldn't be on the market out there. You know, just putting it out there, I guess, but you know,
well,
the problem with laws is enforcement, of course.
So consider this, the market, the U.S. believes that it's certainly with the way pesticides are regulated and registered, they believe it's a self-correcting system. If you purchase a product that doesn't work, you won't buy it again. So I think as much as it's important to have a regulatory system that makes these demands, it's also important for the people listening here right now to ask for them. It's going to cost a few extra shekels. What can I tell you? It's not cheap to innovate. So if an operation is trying to sell a sprayer with a margin that's so tight that the cup holder is going to put you into the competitor's pocket, then maybe we should reassess what it is we're looking for in a sprayer. And I've had this conversation with some very forward-thinking people that are looking to future-proof their sprayer, and they see continuous rinse, they see recirculating booms, they see pulse width modulation as a way for their investment to carry forward when regulatory does change and demand that they have these things. It won't be the same for big groups that'll trade their sprayer in after so many years, but for the smaller operators, these investments are huge, and they want to make sure they leapfrog ahead and have something they can drive for years. So the onus is on the operator to ask for it too.
Okay, so hold on here. If we're gonna add some of those things, the cost, it's getting, you're pushing the price higher. Sprayers are already really increasing in prices. I think Eric, who's watching on Facebook, asked a fantastic question, and that is, what features on a sprayer do we not need? We need more, but cost is getting up there already. So we talked about this already. If we're gonna add, we gotta take away. It works in the vice versa. So let's talk about that.
He's in your ballpark, buddy. Go get him. How about dropping two wheels and towing it?
You know, that's a good question. Maybe we don't need the engine and the drivetrain. That's an expensive and heavy part of the sprayer. It makes the whole system less efficient. But you know, we also need the right tractor to tow the pole type. And it has to have the right clearance and has to have the right tread width and tires and all that other stuff. I mean, it's not an easy change. Often tractors have fluid in their tires for traction. And in the spraying side of things, you maybe don't want that fluid. That's not an easy change. So, you know, there are certain limits to what you can do. But that's a great question. I mean, I've always focused on the fact that what we get is overpriced. But maybe we don't need it all either, you know.
Filters, windshields, nozzles, it's all a waste. Come on.
Go back to the days of open cab sprayers.
Yeah, you know, that's one of my favorite pictures, actually. It's from Lethbridge, of all places. I got from the Ag Tech Center back in the day, and it's a fellow in the sprayer, open cab, without a shirt on. And those were the days, eh? But I do appreciate the features. There's no question about it. I just think that we're paying a lot of money for them, and we're not really meeting all of our needs. I think that tightening the belt on the production side, the engineering side, I don't know what the financials are of these companies, but I do think that all evidence points to a bit of a, you know, unfair retailing.
So, Tom, you know, we were both at the last Agrotechnica. We did some videos together from there talking about some of the observations. We see at European shows, you're comparing to Europe, we see a lot more pull type sprayers. So obviously in something like corn becomes a little bit more tricky. But is that something that we start to see a bit of a resurgence as the price of the self-propelleds gets higher and higher?
Hard to say. You know, in some ways, the availability lags as well. Like the North American pull type manufacturers are essentially out of the business with a few exceptions. So there's not a lot of selection in the pull type market. We've basically been railroaded into a self-propelled market. But we're watching Europeans see this North American market potential and bringing their products over. But interestingly, they're bringing their self-propelleds over because there's a margin there that they want to take advantage of. Horse is bringing their self-propelled. Amazon is bringing their self-propelled. They have pull types too. Their pull types are, in fact, excellent. But maybe that train has left the station. You know, it's another thing about sort of the profitability of farming. I mean, you vote with your dollar. If you can afford it and if it pencils out, dollars per acre, then buy it. And maybe we're doing all right then. Maybe that's a measure.
Well, hey, Paul points out sprayers are now 600,000 to 700,000. Sprayers are priced to what the market will pay. It used to be 200,000. Let's hold on here.
You know, Sean, that's a great comment by Paul, because I remember it wasn't that long ago, maybe 5 years ago, when the R series of John Deere was introduced and they broke the $400,000 retail price barrier. I was shocked when I saw that.
Yeah.
It didn't take long to add another 300,000 to that tag. And what additional things do we have? Well, we have another maybe 400 gallons in the tank capacity. We might have another 20 feet, 10 feet, 15 feet on boom width. What else have we really got?
Todd says direct injection has helped him reduce fill times. Comment on that, boys?
Well, that's a very specific system. It's been promised for years and years. And we wrote an article on this not long ago. It's better than it was. But I think one of its big limitations is still the chemistry that we're trying to spray through it. The way it works for those not in the know is your boom is clean and the chemistry is injected upstream somewhere before the manifold. And that way you're really only getting part of the sprayer dirty. And when you're done, you have a clean water tank instead of a solution tank and a lot less product to deal with. But it really only makes economic sense for custom applicators at the moment that are going out to spray customers who maybe don't want the same tank mix. Consider that they load up, head out, and spray, and the next operator wants more glyphosate or they want an adjuvant. That means returning back to the yard, possibly cleaning the sprayer out, but certainly reloading it. Whereas if you plan it correctly, you can just inject on the fly, depending if you've got however many tanks, to satisfy the next customer down the road, and all you have to do is have water meet you there. So in that sense, direct inject is great. And we said at the beginning of this, Sean, none of the things that we talk about fit everybody. But you know, this is one of those examples where you assess your needs and you try to figure out, this is my biggest problem. I've timed it. What's out there that'll help me get over it? And Todd and his group have fixed it with direct inject. It's, for them, it works great.
It's a great fit, you know, and you don't have to be a huge farmer either to make for it to make sense. Let's take a look at this example. You know, if you're farming in Western Canada and you're doing a pre-seed burn-off and you've got to cover all your acres before seeding, but someone's already seeding. And so you've got labor tied up with running the seeder and tendering that whole system. That's another one or two people. Now the tender to the sprayer is not available. So direct injection gets you acres when labor is limited. So even if it's just for glyphosate, you know, it has an ideal fit for those single use single tank mixes, or I guess lack of a tank mix. But there are a few of those that remaining. Glyphosate is still one of them, even though we advise against it for burn-off. But in-crop glyphosate, Liberty, glufosinate is another one. Makes a lot of sense there.
Comment here from Claire. Talks about how recirculating booms help decrease cleaning time, he finds. What else we got here? Jim Hale. Watch it on Facebook. I think this regards to in terms of lowering the cost. Retrofit for older units, booms, structure and width, PWM, nozzle by, nozzle control, turn compensation, and tank extension. I think those are, anyway, those are all the things that Jim's thinking about in terms of features in the sprayer.
I love them. I mean, that's it. So let's tackle the first comment about boom recirculation. That's another retrofit, right? So what we're trying to do here is saying, all right, we've got a frame, we've got motors on the wheels, we've got an engine. Hopefully they can last more than 5,000 hours, right? And so we have a sound infrastructure. So why not upgrade the components that are actually relatively inexpensive? We can change the plumbing. We can change the delivery through PWM, all that stuff. We can you know, have our tank extended rather than buy a new sprayer. It is a very valid way of increasing your productivity and your overall technical relevance.
I agree. And some of these features, I've learned so much about these over the years from people with experience with them and just, you know, doing the math on seeing the advantages. Some of these shouldn't be features. Some of these should be must-haves. It wasn't long ago, Helmut Spicer, who was the field crop sprayer specialist. If we're quiet, we can probably all hear him right now. Helmut could control a room.
Yeah.
So Helmut would have me out at these demos, and it was 10 years ago that they were talking about recirculating booms. And all I could think was, that's a lot more line to have to clean out. I confess, I just didn't get it. And it was several years before there was finally a system that made a lot of sense to me. And now, if I were in the market for a sprayer, it's a must have. And if you've never tried to unscrew an end cap on a boom section, one time through is pretty much all you need to crack the pocket open and retrofit your sprayer.
Absolutely. Yeah. But I still find guys that I see them and they have a cap on their boom. And I said, well, why haven't you changed that? And they said, well, I've never actually opened that cap. Going,
oh, really? That's not good.
You kind of have to pick your battles, don't you? Like, so you hear someone say that and it rocks you back onto your heels for a moment and you think, okay, maybe I can help you in a different way. And you just sort of, you know, go down a little bit. So when's the last time you changed your nozzles? Well, I bought the sprayer in 88. So then, maybe we got to go further back.
But no, it's hard to understand when to change your nozzles. I mean, you know, the technology hasn't stood still, but it's still relatively constant. I mean, the nozzles that were all the rage 5 years ago are still very good. You know, we haven't had a complete wholesale turnover. So the question is really one of assessing wear and so on. And frankly, they don't wear that fast either. You know, many people can do 30, 40,000 acres on a set of nozzles. That's a lot of time. So
see, there's another disconnect between hort and field crops. We spray a lot of wettable powders under tremendous pressure. And a lot of our sprayers don't have the smaller operations, maybe don't have rate controllers. So as a nozzle wears and as the flow increases, they do recognize that they're going not quite so far on a tank. That's their first indication something's wrong. On the field cropper's side, unless you're watching for it, maybe the rate controller compensates for that. I don't know. But I think it's wrong to think that flow is the only indication of a problem. The distortion, the wear on a cap can also change your spray quality, not your cap, your nozzle, can also change your spray quality quite a bit. And with our attention on spray quality and drift and what it can do for coverage, it's even more important to recognize how many hours you put a nozzle through. You're right. I wish we had some system where we could plug it into a test bench so you didn't have to do, you know, 72 nozzles times however many are on the turrets. Nobody will do that. Nobody would ever do that. Be nice to look, though.
We're getting some great comments tonight. I'm trying to get to as many of the questions as I can. I'm putting some of the comments up on the screen as well. Love all the participation from everybody watching on YouTube, Twitter, and Facebook. It is great stuff here tonight. Before we get to our next clip on cleanout, we've been talking a little bit about cleanout already, but we're going to get to that video here in a second. Daryl Franzi watching on Facebook has a good one. We talked about speed reducing efficacy. Besides environmental conditions, what variable contributes most to poor efficacy?
Wow.
Jason, go for it.
Dude, we're going to be here till tomorrow night. Jeez. Okay, well, let's follow this down the line. Since you mentioned speed, what is the direct impact of driving too quickly? We've talked about speeding up and slowing down. We could talk about boom swaw, which is Tom and I's MASH word for yaw and sway. The boom's kind of swinging forward and going back on acceleration and deceleration. But really, the big impact of driving too quickly is raising your booms. You do it so that you don't smack them, right? So you raise your boom, and what happens? Now your nozzles are much further from the target. And we've said many times, the spray quality, the droplet size produced by a nozzle are, it's variable. There's a span. There are big droplets and little droplets. The big ones will move in a relatively straight line. And the small ones are like my 13-year-old. They do whatever the heck they want. So the higher the boom is, the more likely you're going to lose those fines. They'll leave the spray and go wherever they want. Maybe they'll get caught up in the wake of the wheels or the boom. Maybe they'll settle eventually, but they're not where you want them to be. So driving fast equals a higher boom. A higher boom equals poor spray quality. Poor spray quality equals non-uniform deposition and increased drift, and very likely affects efficacy if we're already skinning the cat a bit with low water volumes. That's one possible, you know, story of how it could work.
Mm-hmm. What about water quality?
Well, water quality is one. I mean, Daryl followed up by suggesting perhaps water, water volume, and certainly water quality. But, you know, I was trying to think of, that's such a great question. It's a fundamental question. We should have a very, you know, a ready answer.
The elevator answer.
And we don't. I don't have an answer. So as you were answering, I was trying to think of, okay, what are the real issues that I've dealt with in my career? I would say probably the improper spray pressure is responsible for more performance complaints than anything else. It leads to two key problems. One of them being the eventual pattern collapse if you go low enough. And of course, too coarse a spray resulting in insufficient coverage for any given water volume. Those have been the most visible ones. The ones that are emerging really are the turbulence ones, which are related to travel speed. So as Jason said, if you have a finer spray, it tends to be more susceptible to the turbulence effects of a chassis or a boom structure. And so that will show up a little more. So as the faster we go, the more that will become a problem. But those are the two big ones. Water quality, I mean, you don't have to have a lot of, you know, if you have water on your farm, you only make a mistake once, right? I mean, when your water's too hard and you have issues with it, you don't just keep going back to that water source. You'd leave it the same way. I mean, we're really talking about treating your water. So that's something that most people have cased, and they only encounter it when they go to a new water source for a brief time.
Okay. Questions are still pouring in, but I want to get to this second clip about sprayer cleaning the tank. This is a fun one because it involves some green goo.
Don't tell them what it is.
Hold on here.
It involves a plug nozzle, doesn't it?
Yeah. Here we go. Here is a video on a sprayer cleanout from Spraymiths.
That tank is spick and span.
Tank's clean, so the whole sprayer's clean. We're ready to go.
Actually, Tom, that's a myth.
There are a lot of sprayer cleaning protocols out there that focus on the sprayer tank, and that's good. But quite often it's the rest of the sprayer that harbors the pesticide residue, creates the contamination problems. That's especially the case when we're using dry formulations.
Well, when I change chemicals, I just put 100 gallons through the tank and flush it out with the boom. It's quick and does the job, right?
Actually, no, Tom. Many of today's herbicides are very active at low rates. Cutting corners to save time can cost thousands in damage claims, even when only trace amounts of pesticide are left in the system.
So, what should I be doing to try to clean my sprayer more effectively?
Well, first, try to avoid problems in the first place. Mix your products in the right order, with the right carrier, with the right agitation.
The right carrier?
Yeah, basically warm, clean water at the right pH. Second, Clean your sprayer as soon as you're done using it, or as soon as possible. Don't let stuff sit in there. Rinse and flush the entire system. That means the tank, all hoses, filters, dual flow metering systems, boom ends, nozzle screens, and of course, nozzles.
I think I finally figured it out. I know how to get this nozzle unplugged.
Looks like I got some blowback there.
I was trying to tell you never clean a nozzle by blowing in it.
Oops. I guess from now on it's triple rinsing, making sure you use the right detergent, and making sure all the sprayer parts are clean, including the exterior.
Good idea. Jeez, it's even in my...
Okay,
you know, funny behind the scenes story there. Tom and I had done a few of these, and we were already pushing the envelope and giving poor Burn conniption fits when we'd give him scripts. And he said, "We're not Hollywood." But when we wrote this, and I said, "Okay, I got to hit Tom with something vile." You guys can ask in the bottom. Maybe we'll tell you what he's actually covered in. But I laughed so damn hard when I threw it, I missed him entirely the first time.
Right. Luckily, you had another quart of it.
I couldn't believe he was going to let me do this. And this was at the Outdoor Farm Show in Ontario. So we were delivering demos and talks all throughout this when we quietly slipped away to film this and cover each other in gack. It was great fun.
Okay, so give us the goods here behind the scenes. What actually was that, Oliver, Tom, and yourself?
It was lime flavored yogurt with green
with food color
in it.
Really?
It was delicious. I ate some later. It was.
I meant to talk to you about that. That sat in the back seat of my car in the hot sun for a whole day before I hit you with it. So probiotic.
That is you know, and we always Jason and I both love classic you know, TV shows that are funny and you know, classic action stuff. And so the you know, when someone's about to open the door to their car but someone else suspects there's a bomb in it, they run towards them and say no in slow motion. So that's what Jason was doing, trying to prevent me from blowing the nozzle clean. You know, it's just like, you know, we allude to these cultural references.
In our defense, Sean, I mean, let's admit this. Working through the physics of spray droplet behavior can be a little boring for some people. I don't know anyone like that, but I'm told some people don't find it riveting.
Seems odd.
One of the things Tom and I do, or try to do, is reintroduce foundational information in a new way. And part of that is being a little self deprecating, I guess. If we're willing to do silly things, then maybe people will pay attention. And it's obvious there's no length we won't go to educate somebody on something they've heard a million times, but we put a bit of a spin on it, or we try.
It took me a long time to warm up to the idea of ridiculing myself on camera for all eternity. And, you know, we would write them and they'd be funny. And then I'd see them for the first time in rough draft. And I'd say, Jason, I don't think I can give you permission to air this.
Yeah. I could see it.
Then we'd give him to Jay Strovey.
You know, yes. Magic.
Unbelievable magic. What he did. Oh, some of the funniest moments in our videos are his creation. He just nails it, you know.
He has a cape and a wand. He is a magician. So Eugene and Jim both asked the same question, like at the same time here. I'll put up Eugene's here. What are the thoughts on front boom versus rear boom?
It's a question that I don't have a really satisfactory answer for. On the one side, I really like the front boom because you can look at the boom and you can see what it's doing. You can see the height, you can correct things, you can see the nozzles or most of them. You can better judge boom height, all the things that are important. It's right there. And the rear boom, you've got to do the 180 from the seat and see it that way. On the other hand, you know, you're driving through stuff that you've just sprayed, and not everyone likes that. So the sprayer itself is a little bit more affected by the herbicide or fungicide or insecticide. And, you know, then also if you stop spraying in the middle of the field, that you might want to stop spraying and then drive forward another couple of tractor lengths to step off the sprayer in an unsprayed site. So those are the kinds of idiosyncrasies. On the other hand, you can drive straight into a corner, full speed, and just stop and square it up and then do your turn and then drive out of the corner spraying, and sort of it gives you more square corner if you don't have turn compensation and you know, other things. So it has pros and cons for me.
Jay?
I've heard a lot of good things about the front boom. Having driven very few sprayers, admittedly, I liked being able to see where everything is, and I suppose that's my utter lack of experience. But I also see a lot of mixed reports on the sprayer driving through the crop. Let's say it's a herbicide application and stirring up seeds and leaving an unsprayed area behind. You've got the nozzles behind the wheels, and in corn you even have a second boom in the back that's meant to fill in where the cab is. So really you kind of have two sections up front and then one in the rear. And having spoken to a lot of guys who do corn, there's not a ton of spray that ends up on the cab. I suppose it all depends on which way is the wind facing and what it is you're actually applying. So I'm really not sure. You know what I'd love to see is some deposition study for where product is on these two sprayers over a long period of time. Maybe that exists and I'm just not aware of it.
Who are the manufacturers? Like, is it who does the front sprayers?
So the front boom is Hagee, which is a corn specific product, but usable in any crop, but it's a high clearance. New Holland has front and rear mount. That's their Miller line. And of course, Miller's still.
Yeah. Well.
That's what I was thinking of.
Okay. So those are the main ones that I'm aware of.
Okay. Claire has a question. What's your nozzle of choice for PWM after switching from air inducted nozzles to a PWM system?
That's timely.
Yeah, I mean, I ask a few questions of the person asking that question first. And first question is what nozzle body style do you have? What lug is it? So if you have a T-jet lug, you are a little bit more limited to your PWM nozzle choice. But a good standby for me has always been the Turbo T-Jet. It's been around for a long time. Turbo Twin Jet. T-Jet has even allowed the air induced version of the Turbo Twin Jet for PWM. Why I like those nozzles is because they have a nice wide fan angle. They have a terrific droplet size pressure response. So if you wanted to change droplet size, a small change in pressure will do that for you nicely. The John Deere line of equipment has their own products. They have the so-called LDX, which is a bit too fine for me in the 3D, and the LDM, which is a little too coarse for me. So there's actually an opening in the middle for them. If you're a New Holland or a Case guy and have had PWM, you know, those machines have had PWM for a long time, at least the Case ones have, they have the Wilger bodies. And the Wilger has a line of nozzles that are specifically designed for PWM, and they have every flow rate and every spray quality you could ever want. So if the Wilger body is on this sprayer, I typically recommend Wilger nozzles because it's a natural fit. You can retrofit Wilger nozzles through a simple adapter onto a T-jet lug as well, but it adds a little bit of space and leak potential and whatever else comes with that.
I got a question for you, Tom.
Yeah, go ahead.
With pulse width modulation comes the ability to take advantage of optics and spot spraying, and I'm seeing more sprayers drop from 20-inch to closer nozzle spacing, and at the same time, they're dropping to a more narrow fan angle. Have you encountered much of that out in the prairies?
You know, it's coming, I guess. We're seeing both of our recent European market entries, Amazon and Horsch, offering a 10-inch option. And the idea really is that it gives you the ability to go with a lower boom. And the only limiting factor for me is, well, can you actually go with a lower boom? And that's right. That's a question. So I see that as I guess the contingency. If you can't go to the lower boom, then there's really no advantage to having a narrower nozzle spacing. It doesn't give you any extra coverage. It gives you smaller nozzles, which can plug more. It gives you more nozzles to service and so on and so forth. So only with a low boom option.
Okay.
Cool. And Jim Hale was, he said Wilger before he even mentioned Wilger, Tom. So
I knew that was coming though.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's a Saskatchewan product, man.
Oh,
they do a good job.
Okay.
Jim and I. Yeah.
Well, you know, we are in prime time. We promised a little bit lighter. I got a request here, Jason, from Ryan watching on Facebook. He wants you to do your Professor Frink impression.
Oh, Ryan. So Ryan's a University of Guelph colleague. He's a potato specialist in PEI and a poker buddy.
Oh, it's that and Ryan Barrett.
And I haven't
Barrett.
Done Frink oh. in so many years, Ryan. Well, the sprayer that we're talking about here today is pulse width modulation, and I love it.
you've now seen it all. That's exactly yeah. That is
a dig for that one.
Oh man,
that's well, awesome!
You know,
that's
Ryan, awesome, I appreciate you asking all about that. That just made my night. Absolutely.
Jeez, Ryan, you just took away lots of years of street cred from me, buddy. Thanks.
Ryan has been a guest on Real Ag Radio several times talking about potato production in the Maritimes. We love having him on there. I didn't realize it was Ryan.
I gotta tell my potato story. I mean, I've been to PEI a few times, but I remember once when I was trying to tell the people at the workshop about productivity. I was telling them about filling faster, and I'm noticing that there's no real uptake of the message. And I said, what's going on? Why is that not resonating with you? And they said, well, you know, our problems are a little different than yours. We actually have to fold up our booms to make every single turn at the end of every pass. And because in the row crops, in potatoes,
oh
in PEI, you can't have headlands because you can't dam the water should it rain and flow because it will just lead to massive erosion. So the and most row crops is like that. Your row crops go right to the road. And of course, there's poles and trees and whatever else and other obstructions. So you actually have to fold up your boom before you make your turn. Can you imagine the productivity loss? So actually, the biggest productivity gain could be from a sprayer that actually folds its booms super fast.
Hey,
yeah, geez, whiplash booms. See, this goes back to how we started. One solution is not right for everybody. It's why we have to stay in the know, and we have to have this conversation with growers to understand what their challenges and their opportunities are to help them find a solution that fits for them.
Well, Jason, I get that 100%. Like for me, when people ask me, what's your job, Tom? I usually say my full-time job is trying to understand farming. And it's not because I don't understand it. You know, I'm from a farm, but my experience on the farm can only take me so far. The challenges are constantly evolving, and my task is to be in tune with those challenges so I can actually have answers. And that's the big challenge, is understand
so true.
What challenges they face. Yeah.
So can we just go back to the front versus rear boom topic again, because Ray asks a question here. So for front boom, you travel over spray path and possibly cover and push product away, and rear boom drags product along but could introduce turbulence. So does the nozzle choice vary whether you're front or rear boom?
Whoa, we need a PhD student.
This is the agronomist. See, this is the audience.
Ray,
I like
gotta
this.
I got to hand it to you, Ray. For a fertilizer guy, that's a really good question, you know. Ray and I know each other from the U of M days. We did our master's degrees around the same time, so we're old buddies. You know, that's a great question. I'll think about that, but I think you might be right. You know, like the, I guess the propensity for displacement is greater with a finer spray. And perhaps a rear-mounted boom might be more susceptible to that if they
Did
want to
we
use a
not
finer
discuss,
spray.
Tom? We've talked about this, and as much as the boom itself can create vortices and problems, it's the sprayer, the wheels and the chassis itself that you see the biggest dips around the wheels. So this is
Yeah.
something I've never considered. This is a great idea.
It's a great question. I appreciate that. It'll get me thinking a little bit. You know, most sprayers, you know, because the wheels are the most important part for turbulence, most sprayers do have an extra nozzle behind the wheel, front or rear mounted,
Right.
or a larger nozzle behind the rear the wheel. So that addresses that's addressed by that question, I guess.
Hey,
It's also
Tom.
a great surprise when you're cleaning.
Yeah.
But Tom, I'll just say you started it. But Ray says Heather won't like knowing Tom's full-time job is solving herbicide problems. So
That's
All
getting
those
personal
comments go
now.
way back, guys. Those are, yeah, that's awesome,
Yeah.
Ray. Thanks.
Okay.
Yeah.
What we got here? Danny Ottenbright watching on Twitter. Is T-Jet the only company making 360-degree tank rinse nozzles?
Absolutely not. So not too long ago, Tom and I have been talking about continuous rinse for some time. And very briefly, it's a way for the operator to perform the equivalent of a triple rinse in a fraction of the time and deliver the rinsate over the field. It's environmentally awesome. It's productivity-wise, it's awesome. It's just plain awesome. But one of the problems in retrofitting it is that the dedicated pump that runs the clean water to the tank has to go through the tank rinse nozzles. And sometimes you can't find a tank rinse nozzle that's going to operate at low pressure or low flow correctly. And it just sort of sadly drizzles. But Leckler has stepped up. And they now have four tank rinse nozzles that are color-coded, just the way a nozzle is with ISO standard. So you can pick your pressure and flow to hit all the inside portions of the tank, no matter, well, roughly what capacity your clean water pump is. And I really wish we had known about this when I started putting them on air blast sprayers, because we ended up building our own. We put this brass deflector plate under. I shouldn't take the credit. It was actually the ag engineers who figured that one out. But it was a way for us to compensate with existing tank rinse nozzles to make up for a less than powerful pump. So no, lots of companies build them.
Okay.
I think Hypro has a line as well as T-Jet, Leckler. Those are the three big ones that I will go to. Is there another one that you're thinking of, Jason, at all that you know of off the top of your
No,
head?
the one that
But those
stood
are
out
the
for me
main
with
ones, yeah.
Leckler was the fact that you could. If you couldn't change the flow from your clean water pump, you could change your tank rinse nozzle to match it. So that was new for me.
Yeah,
Okay,
absolutely. Yeah.
a couple more here before we wrap up. Ryan says he has a serious question now. Is there a payoff in individual nozzle control for VR spraying?
I think so. I mean, individual nozzle control to me implies not just sectional control, but also rate control to that individual nozzle. And PWM offers that to some degree. I think the software is the only thing really lagging behind between nozzle by nozzle individual rate control. So, you know, Capstan, for example, is working on that exact thing where every single one of the 72 nozzles can put out its own unique rate. And so that would be high resolution VR spraying. And I see that you know the value of that depends on, of course, what your implementation is. I mean, right now, for example, in the fungicide world, it's an on or off situation, you know, with a climate field view, for example, piloting that a little bit. So they're just saying, hey, look, this is a drowned out spot, you're not going to get anything here anyway, so shut the boom down. And they do that with their satellite maps, and that's good enough. But if you're trying to get more in maybe into some high value stuff, even higher value stuff, maybe you're doing some site-specific fertility, maybe you're doing some herbicide work because you have an excellent herbicide map, then you would benefit from that additional VR capability that PWM offers you. So yeah, I do see that as an option. I mean, right now it's more section by section. I see things. I think one of the trends I see in the spraying business is that our VR capability is going to be resolved finer and finer over time. I see that, for example, through the weed detecting sprayer nozzles that respond to green, and they just turn on and off instantaneously and do a square foot of spray. So that's a very finely resolved VR, and I suppose a spot spray. And we're seeing that maybe migrating into conventional spraying more and more as our maps get better.
Yeah, Ryan points out he's seeing interest in it for weeds or foliar and in potatoes. That's the beauty. We have covered everything from potatoes in the Maritimes to like a pulse crop in Alberta. I love it. That's the beauty of real agriculture. It makes me so proud. Let's finish up with this, guys, and remind everybody, if you are a CCA and looking for credits, go to realagriculture.com/agronomist in the morning, and we'll have the button up for you to register for your CCA credits. Let's talk about building up. We talked about features you would take off the sprayer. Let's talk about building up from the ground here. Viewer, I'm not even going to try the name. Let's go with Kyler. Watching on YouTube, if you're building a sprayer from the wheels up, what would standards would you be after? I don't know if you mean standards or features, but I'll let you guys tackle it.
It's too much. We gave this talk not too long ago, and we could barely hit the high water marks of chassis, cab comfort, visibility, the ability of the sprayer to go a certain speed but still stay stable, booms being level or even matching contour, the ability to control where spray is going, either through pressure control or maybe even air assist or shrouds. It's endless. The plumbing. Do you want it as simple as possible so that you know when it's clean? Automation, clarity. Wow, I don't even know where to begin. We need a whole other call for this question.
It's a great question. I love it. So you know, it's like this. I would say if I was going to build a sprayer, I always gravitate to certain statistics when I look at new sprayers. First one I go to is weight. Do they have the guts to publish it? You know, and it's actually becoming sometimes harder to find. But I look for a light sprayer primarily because of soil conditions and also the ability to actually carry water. We can sink out of sight with these units. The second one is I do want smart plumbing. I accept that booms are almost on an equal footing there. But smart plumbing, I appreciate smart plumbing. You know, any operator appreciates smart plumbing every time they fill and clean, flush, rinse, prime. That's when that becomes really valuable. The boom leveling, we've talked about that. That's everyone is equally, I think, disappointing. We'll see what the Europeans can offer. But that's where I would go. And, then there's little things. There's things like, are we overpowered here? Are we putting a lot of fuel in that thing, a lot of DEF, to get power to climb a hill at 18 miles an hour when we don't really need that? What if we get smarter with other things and only have to climb that hill at 12 miles an hour? That also matters.
Yeah. Oh, boy. Some great stuff. Awesome conversation. I'll say this. You guys will be coming back throughout the winter here on another episode of The Agronomist. I promise you guys, and I promise the audience, some fantastic questions. Even stumped the guests tonight, which I absolutely love. It speaks to the quality of the viewership. People are tuning in here every Monday night for Real Ag in primetime for The Agronomist. And we'll be back here every single week through the winter. And Tom and Jason, really appreciate you joining us here today.
Thank you for everything, Sean, over the many years. I think our video collaboration has been really fun.
Absolutely.
Yeah, thanks for having us here, and thanks for the support. You've had us out to Tech Tour Live. You allowed us to make our own comic book. I'll have to plug Micron Woman for people who don't know. A personal best in it's one of my bucket lists to make a comic book, and Real Agriculture helped us do that.
Well, it's great to be a part of it, guys. Really appreciate it. Okay, I want to remind everybody that, of course, if you missed any of tonight's show, you can find it in our on our website, realagriculture.com/agronomist, or, of course, on our YouTube channel is a good example of where it will live. You have a month to watch to get the CCA credit, so please check that out. I don't know what we're going to be talking about next week. I do know this. Make sure tomorrow you check out Real Ag Radio on Rural Radio 147 at 4:30 Eastern, as well as Real Ag Live tomorrow as well at 3 p.m. Eastern, right here streaming live to take your questions. We're talking about ag policy tomorrow with the grain growers of Canada. Thanks, everybody, for getting real and getting connected with the agronomists, and we'll see you again next week. Cheers, everybody.